In September of 1970, a somewhat psychedelicized drawing of Elliott Gould's face appeared on the cover of Time magazine with the words star for an uptight age. Now, I was this Jewish kid with a Jufro, and I thought it was terrific that this unbelievable star had legitimized curly hair for us, where we'd been trying to have it straightened ever since the Beatles. Elliott, who was married to Barbara Streisand at the time, was in the midst of an extraordinarily productive period that began in 1969 with Paul Mazursky's Bob, Carol, Ted, and Alice, for which he received an Oscar nomination. And by 1973, he had been in Robert Altman's MASH and The Long Goodbye. During this period, he took a break from Hollywood to appear in, I'm sure you don't remember this, Ingmar Bergman's first English language picture, The Touch. Today, younger audiences know Elliott Gould best from his recurring role in Friends and as Ruben Tishkoff in the Ocean's 11 remake and its sequels. He also appeared in last year's independent romantic comedy Dorfman and in this year's Ruby Sparks. Let's take a look at some highlights from Elliott Gould's illustrious career.
So what do you think, Ben? Am I dreaming, or am I really out here in Hollywood with you?
Are you here, Harry?
Thank God. If I was anyplace else, I'd be dead.
Look, Mother, I want to go to work in 1 hour. We are the pros from Dover, and we figure to crack this kid's chest and get out to the golf course before it gets dark. So you go find the gas passer, and you have him pre-medicate this patient. Then bring me the latest pictures on him. The ones we saw must be 48 hours old by now. Then call the kitchen and have them rustle us up some lunch. Ham and eggs will be all right. Steak would be even better. And then give me at least one nurse who knows how to work in close without getting her tits in my way. Where the hell are standards? That's what I kept asking myself. I mean, those people will take anything. Hell, if I give them a picture of shit, they'd probably give me an award for it.
Not too long ago.
Derek, what are you trying to prove?
Murray, stay out of it. Come on.
She can't breathe.
6 years old, and I gotta start using condoms.
Dad.
And it's crazy.
Dad, stop.
By the time you get it out of the package, you lose your
erection. Dad.
When my time comes, I want to be buried at sea.
You what?
I want to be buried at sea. It looks like fun.
It's not a game anymore!
You're damn right it isn't, and it never was.
Why?
It's all there! It's all there in Toynbee and those books on the shelf! Suppression breeds violence! You're gonna raise the curfew 1 hour? Will you look outside? You see that, kid? Last week, he just wanted to get laid. Now he wants to kill somebody.
Go home!
You should have let him get laid. Hey, watch it.
I'm sorry, but I have to get a contract so I can go out and kill him.
I'm thinking of enlisting.
They'll never take you.
That's why I'm thinking of enlisting.
You're on a story, aren't you?
I was fired.
You're on a story, and I'm helping you. This can't be happening.
I really appreciate that.
The only reason I'm doing it, considering your track record, whatever story you're on will turn out to be garbage.
You shouldn't mince words.
I'm Vance Fowler, secretary to the New York Society for the Suppression...
Fowler, you're here more than I am. Why do you always introduce yourself? Believe me, you're unforgettable.
I find your sketches to be lewd, and several of the dance numbers to contain suggestive movement.
Oh, be specific.
Look, where did get come away from here,
military,
Alan. You're not a doctor, and you're not a writer.
Organism. Yes, I am a writer. Yes, I am.
Blogging is not writing. It's graffiti with punctuation.
I know more about casino security than any man alive. I invented it, and it cannot be beaten. They got cameras, they got watches, they got locks, they got timers, they got vaults. They got enough armed personnel to occupy Paris. Okay, bad example.
So, how's therapy?
He said I'm a perfect candidate for antidepressants.
I don't like drugs.
You used to.
Alice, it must be 50 million men having an affair right this second, and not one of them's going to go and tell his wife, and Bob has to go and tell Carol.
The point is not that he told her. The point is that he did it. that he cheated on his wife, that he cheated on Kara.
I agree, that's bad. But I think you'll agree with me that if he hadn't told her, there'd be no problem.
Straight now, I saw that man walking in the Pacific Ocean gave Dr. whatever his name, $5,000 for an alibi so you could keep your job. I'm going to go and I'm calling Ronald Reagan and getting you kicked your ass off. You're going to be selling bus tickets, you son of a bitch. You don't deserve to be alive, you pig.
Elliott Gould appears tonight in conversation with San Francisco Chronicle movie correspondent Ruthe Stein. Please join me in welcoming Elliott Gould and Ruthe Stein to the San Francisco JCC.
So we have been having a wonderful discussion about this year's movies, as only people who love movies like we do can talk about them. And we're both huge fans of the film Lincoln, but you were telling me that such an interesting thing about your perspective on Silver Lining Notebook. Oh. And I wonder if you could share that with the audience.
Well, I've studied David O. Russell's work since I saw one of his early films called Spanking the Monkey.
I saw that.
And we met over The Fighter. And we didn't really meet, but I was aware of his work. And there was a gathering, and we didn't have a chance to say hello to one another, and he called me. I was extremely touched that he would call me. Because with all due respects, who am I and who is anyone? and then I've just seen Silver Lining Notebook. No, Silver.
Playbook.
I understand.
Playbook.
Well, I
got
I'll take
it wrong.
My time. I mean, every pianist has to warm up a little bit, right? As Silver Linings Playbook. Joe Morgenstern, who's a lifelong friend, he's the critic for the Wall Street Journal, wrote a review. He sends me his reviews, so I went to see it, and I just was so impressed with it, and especially the leading lady, Jennifer Lawrence. And you want me to say that after I saw the film, I emailed my son Jason's mother, my first wife, to say, don't miss this picture. Oh, her name's Barbara. don't miss this picture. It's just fabulous. And Jennifer Lawrence is the first original that has reminded me of you. And the next morning, I had the briefest response, me too, she said.
So I wanted to talk a little bit about your son, you and Barbara's son. I know you have three other children. And he toured with his mother recently, and he sang on stage. And there was the story that he sang beautifully with her, a duet. And there was a story that she had no idea that he could sing until very, very recently. And then I read your quote also, in which you said you were very surprised to find out that he was such a wonderful singer as well. So you never heard him sing? He never sang for you?
No, that's not true. He had done, I mean, Jason has had a very interesting and different kind of life. Since he didn't really know his mother and father together, which, as far as I'm concerned, is such a great loss and leaves such an enormous gap. So Jason had never been on stage and decided to act in London in a play called Twilight of the Golds. And it was put up, performed, and staged at the Art Theater, which was the first theater that Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot was directed and produced. And in Act Two, his character danced with his sister, and he sang, Jason sang, four bars of Killing Me Softly, mm-hmm. and the hair on my neck stood up. He'd asked me to come and see his dress rehearsal, and he asked me to see his opening night. I would have come back a third time and brought Barbara, but Barbara either wasn't available or we hadn't coordinated it. In the stories leading up to this amazing duet that the mother and the son do together, that they've toured a good part of North America with, and they sing How Deep Is the Ocean.
Mm. Oh, it's beautiful.
She said that she had heard him hum when he was a child. And meanwhile, Barbara turned 70 in April, and Jason made a short film for her. I'm even in it because he has everything at the beginning. He has his mother and his father and himself as this little newborn baby.
And Barbara shows his film on concert, so it's beautiful because we can all share that and see what that experience is.
Yeah, well, you're going to help me all the way, aren't you? Right. And he sings Nature Boy on the film. And Quincy Jones, who's an iconic music person, said to Barbara's lifelong manager, Marty Ehrlichman, who's singing? And Marty told me very proudly, that's Jason Gould. And so Quincy would like to do an album with Jason. And then I called the Bergmans, Alan and Marilyn, who are very good friends. I wasn't at the party, but many of our friends were there. Including the Beatties and a whole bunch of people. But Marilyn and Alan are Hamish people. And of course, you should know they wrote The Way We Were and Windmills of Your Mind and What Are You Doing the Rest of Your Life? And I called them and they said to me, oh, we want to apologize to you. I said, what about? They said, we should have called you. I said, I don't think that way. I'm calling you because I know you're friends. You're our friends. How did you feel? How did he do? What did you think? And they said to me, well, you know, we've always known he was gifted and always known that he was talented and what with his films and different things he's done, but he's really put it together now. And now they want to write for him. And so talk about Nachis.
Well, people were talking about, well, of course, he inherited the voice from his mother, but you're a singer, a professional singer. You started out on a musical stage. You can sing too, right?
Oh, nothing like them, please.
I was going to ask you to sing for us.
I just might, you know. I just might, you know. I mean, I do segue. And I really enjoy improvising, especially since I have no script. But I might do that, you know. I mean,
you'll tell me when you're ready.
I'll show you when I'm ready.
That sounds great. Well, I want, of course, to talk about your movies, the road that you did take. You've just had an amazing screen career from the 1960s to the present, and you're a link between the past generations, the hippie generations, and the current generation. This gentleman has made 75 movies over 35 years. I don't know if anyone can challenge that. And even more impressive, he hosted Saturday Night Live a half dozen times. So I was trying to think what it must have been like for you to turn, I think you were around 32 when Time magazine put your face on the cover of the magazine. And in a sort of a psychedelic likeness of it, and you were identified as a star for an uptight age. Did that go to your head? Did you buy a lot of copies of the magazine?
Actually, it went to my feet. I was a tap dancer, and so I could make rhythm with my feet. I really started out in song and dance as a child, and the reason that I did, as far as my perception would allow me to sort of assess, was that I was extremely inhibited and shy and repressed, and there were others like me, and I rationalized that if I memorized routines, and my life is not about memorizing anything, but if I could memorize a routine, then perhaps I could learn to communicate through that which I had memorized, and it worked.
So what was it like to have your face on the cover of Time magazine?
Well, there were two faces, because in the United States, there was that painting that you mentioned, sort of psychedelic, but in Canada, and possibly Europe as well, they had the photograph of me and the full cover of Time magazine as Trapper John, and they said, the man from MASH. I was the man from MASH for Time magazine. So there were actually two different, one was a painting and one was a photograph. Inside, they have a picture of my mother, my father, and me. It was a little embarrassing as far as my lack of knowledge, my lack of understanding, my having made a significant breakthrough, which was so unexpected. But I think it was September 7th or 9th of 1970, and I had the opportunity to go to Stockholm, Sweden, and be the first one of us, not just a Jew, but I mean that as the basis for my culture, but an American Jew to work with and for Ingmar Bergman. So I wasn't here. Could it have gone to my head? I don't know that I had a head at that point. I had a mustache, you know. I enjoyed my mustache.
Well, why don't we talk about Ingmar Bergman? And then we'll get to Robert Altman right afterwards. This is quite an honor. This is the first. He was the first director to make him. He made a movie in English. That was the first time when you. When you made that film, that was the first time you worked in English?
Ingmar,
yeah.
Right, yeah.
What do you recall about that experience?
I recall just about everything, you know. I mean, I'm here to learn. I recall two or three definite, specific memories when I was around 14 months old. My father was Bernard, and my mother was Lucille. My father had a brother and a sister, Adolf and Pearl. I'm second generation. My parents were born here in America. And I was asked if I would talk with a man from Life magazine who was preparing an article about Ingmar Bergman and our collaboration with me. And I spoke with him for about 4 hours before I came across to do that picture. And while we were speaking, he said, bring a pad and pencil with you. And I said, oi, I appreciate that. It's one of the best things we can do for me. Allow me to say oi. I said, I hope I haven't spoken with you prematurely. I'm not coming across for your piece. I'm coming across to see if I can act with the finest white actors in the world, and also being that it appeared that I had a very fertile, promising career as a producer. It interests me. I know chemistry. I'd like to do chemistry, like to put us all to work. And as a matter of fact, this man right in the middle here looks a little like Billy Wilder, who in his latter days said to me, if there's anything you want to do, please tell me, because I'd love to work with you. Compliment as far as Billy Wilder, who I didn't work with, but was one of our great, great film artists. And I wanted to come and see if I could sustain myself and also see about an equation. I had already produced one picture, and there were other pictures for me to produce with partners, and because I wasn't a businessman. And I came back, and called Richard Merriman after we did the touch. And I said, is there time for me to say something, to contribute something to your article? There's something I'd like to say. And he said, yes. So I said to him, I said, this is interesting because, I have evolved somewhat since then. And I said, I couldn't fully accept all of the privileges that were given to me because I appeared to be so successful so soon in this career. And whether it was the privilege of working with the outstanding director or writer or conductor, that I believe, and I do with all my heart, that the great privilege is to be conceived, born, and know yourself, and that everything follows. So, I had a lot to learn about reality in the world. And, these are stepping stones, or were stepping stones for me to get right here, to be right here. I was saying in the green room earlier, when I met some of you, and I'm really impressed with this audience and the center getting you all here and for me to talk with you, because I am trying to, so we'll continue.
I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about what it was like to work with Bergman. I understand this film was partially autobiographical, or you had said that at one point, and it sounded like there was some rough stretches during
nothing. That's interesting because I'd heard that just recently, in recent years. You had said, Ruth, that you've read that I'm doing a lot. I go to festivals. I stand by my work, and especially when I have an opportunity to work with people and for people. I love to work for people and with people. But they showed the new print of The Touch, the Bergman film, at LACMA, museum in Los Angeles. And in recent years, I've seen the film a couple of three times with an American audience that has really wanted to see it, because the picture, I believe, is far more radical and far more revolutionary than it was sold. And at the time, it was thought that Ingmar Bergman, with me, might be very commercial. And there was business that was desired for that to evolve to. And they sold it as a picture with this amazing woman, Bibi Anderson, me as this other man. Max von Sydow is one of the greatest actors ever in film. And Bergman had said to me, if you think he's good in film, wait till you see him do Peer Gynt for 5.5 hours. He knows everything. He's just amazing. And I played basketball with him. I mean, we played basketball in Stockholm. But the picture's about the woman. It's not about a woman and a man. It's about the woman. And it's so much more revolutionary than we could have afforded, or the system or the establishment could have afforded to sell or to present to an audience. But we did the picture, and so Bergman worked with me, and I came back to America, and then sort of had to, I blew almost all of my career because it was important for me to stay free and not to be a prisoner or to my success and allow fear to reign in relation to being afraid to lose something, to lose the success. I'll find my way again, I always do.
I think you found it, haven't you?
Well, I have, but like I said, I'm trying to talk. It's not really what I do.
I do want to talk about Robert Altman, that wonderful genius you worked with many times, including playing yourself in two of his movies. And I'd like to start with A Long Goodbye, which is just wonderful. If you haven't seen it, you should absolutely see it. There's an amusing story. Michael Connelly interviewed Mr. Gould about that film, and he's a huge fan of Philip Marlowe, of the whole character, and he pointed out that in the paperback version of the book, there's you and the cat, and then in the first 5 minutes of the movie, it's all about you and a cat, but there's no cat in the novel, right?
Mm-hmm. What Raymond Chandler, who wrote the material, yeah. who wrote The Long Goodbye, had many cats. And I recall when the David Picker, who was running United Artists, had given me the script of The Long Goodbye, which had been written by Lee Brackett, adapted by Lee Brackett, who originally had collaborated with William Faulkner on the screenplay of The Big Sleep, and gave me the script. And it was written in another time. They had another director. I do believe Peter Bogdanovich thought they would use him. And Bogdan and I was looking for a job. This was post Bergman, post that part of my career. And I'll go back there if we've got the time and you allow me to. But with Altman, they gave it to Robert Altman. And Altman called me from Ireland, where he was finishing a picture called Images. And he said to me, "What do you think?" And I said, "I've always wanted to play this guy." And Altman said to me, "You are this guy." And that was the beginning of the picture. With the cats, Altman called me and said, here's the picture, and this is the theme of it. I mean, there's a cat, and he tries to give him food that isn't right, and you can't lie to your cat. And
you go shopping
for
the food.
That was all Robert Altman. Robert Altman, yeah.
There's hardly a scene, I think, where you're not smoking. Were you actually smoking at that time?
No, I can't. I could never inhale. I mean, I'm not in denial. I couldn't inhale. I could inhale other things, but not tobacco.
Should we go there?
I've already left. I'm gone. You know, so I don't. You know, I mean, I recently met Shaquille O'Neal, and I said, people sometimes will say to me, "Are you serious?" And I can now say I don't have to be so serious any longer. I know I'm honest. And like I've been saying, it's taken me forever to get here. You know, part of me wants to go back to Ingmar Bergman to straighten out a few things, because I've endured. Bergman dismissed all of his English-speaking pictures, including The Touch. And when I went to LACMA and talked, and looked at the new print, people from the Swedish film community and the Bergman Institute were there and asked me to come back to Stockholm to present it to them, to present The Touch to them again, and I did, you know. And even though he was the composer and it was his life, it was about the woman who married him and stayed married to him for the rest of her life, it's a masterpiece. And when I mentioned,
and it is available.
You can find it online. And then speaking about with Altman, California Split, because I used to gamble, and believe me, this was a gamble for me to come out here and express myself without understanding anything. I mean, I'm so grateful. And so blessed, you know.
So I want you to talk about one scene in particular. Your character, Philip Marlowe, and a whole bunch of other people are gathered in the office of a Jewish gangster played by Mark Rydell, and he wants, for some reason, everybody to take off their clothes. And what's great is that you do not take off your clothes, but there's a guy behind you, very large guy, very built, who immediately starts stripping, and his name was?
Well, that was Arnold Schwarzenegger. So this was his first or second picture, and Arnold, they call background, he was an extra in it. Let's see, Mark Rydell played Marty Augustine. It was all about money, and also he wanted the fabulous David Arkin, who was in many, many of Altman's pictures, with me as well, to be a moyle. They wanted me to, because they wanted to threaten me, because they thought I had the money, and of course I didn't have the money, and so Mark Rydell was writing a scene, because Altman did a lot of improvising, And so he was writing a scene where they wanted to crucify me. And I said, I'm not going to get naked. You'll all have to get naked first before I get naked. And that's the way it was. And then the money got returned, and I sort of escaped with my self in one piece.
What's so funny about the scene is the eagerness with which Mr. Schwarzenegger takes off his clothes. He's practically ready to strip down before anyone else has even started.
Well, he was Mr. Olympia.
I know, he's Mr. Universe, right?
I know.
You've often talked about wanting to do a sequel where you play an older Philip Marlowe. Has anyone got any place with that?
Well, I did quite a bit of work with the Raymond Chandler estate, and I had done readings, books on tape of just about all of Chandler's material, and found a little-known short novel called The Curtain. And it wasn't Philip Marlowe, it was John Dalmas. And you could see where the big sleep came from. And in The Curtain, the Bacall character has a 10-year-old son, and he's the killer. And that really interested me to deal with a young child who has killed his stepfather. I started to work with Bob on it, and then Alan Rudolph, who's a filmmaker, mm-hmm. a very good filmmaker in his own right, who was the second assistant director on The Long Goodbye, he wrote a first draft for me, but we could not find the money to make the picture, but I'm grateful to have been able to do The Long Goodbye. But I won't give up until I can't do it anymore, because as an older person, and a much older person, this guy's ethics and morality is still intact.
Fascinating.
Yeah, you don't have to be too old to care.
Well, let's talk about some of the movies you turned down, which is just an amazing list, starting with McCabe and Mrs. Miller. What happened with that?
Well, it was a book called McCabe that 20th Century Fox had bought for George C. Scott. And then Bo and Bob and I became so hot after MASH, I was making a picture called Move at Fox that Pandro S. Berman, who had produced Gunga Din, and was a great iconic Hollywood producer, was making Move with me. And Altman asked me if I would do his picture of called The Presbyterian Church Wager, which was based on McCabe. And the first page was the town in the present with a 360-degree camera turn, and then it was the past. And I said to Bob, I don't think you have to do that. Start it. It's now. It's then now. Everything is now. And then I was being offered a property at Universal called I Love My Wife. And the truth is that I did not have a relationship that I understood. And Bob wanted me to do McCabe and Mrs. Miller with the actress who had played Alice in Alice's Restaurant, Pat Quinn. Oh. Fabulous, just fabulous. So I decided to go with where the business people were pushing me to do I Love My Wife. And I thought, we all know I do, but I didn't have the strength or the courage to stop working for a while because I had made a significant breakthrough. And Bob said to me, Altman said to me, you're making the mistake of your life and not doing my picture. I said, first of all, it's not my life yet. And second of all, you can't take away that I was your first choice. And someday I look at it and say, wow, what a masterpiece. And you wanted me to play that guy. Meanwhile, Warren Beatty and Julie Christie are fabulous. But the truth of the matter is we would have loved to have had a Jewish McCabe.
And then ironically, Warren Beatty, who of course did end up playing McCabe, he would talk to you about playing the Al Pacino part in Dick Tracy. What happened with that film?
Well, it got made, and Al,
right,
I thought Al was great. It couldn't have been done better.
Did you hesitate?
The story was when Warren called me, and this I think may have been pre-Bugsy. And Warren called me, because we're friends. He was at Jason and Barbara's concert with Annette. They were thrilled, and he was at the party. I wasn't at the party, but he was at the party.
You mentioned that now a couple of times. Was there some bad feelings about that?
It'd be just too embarrassing. I get along fine with Jim Brolin, and he's very nice to me.
You made a movie with him once, right?
I did. As a matter of fact, I said, you know, when Capricorn One was on the air in London, I said, don't miss it, because you'll never see me together with Jim Brolin and O.J. Simpson again.
O.J. Simpson? Oh, yeah, my God. Right.
I made a movie with Robert Blake, too.
Yeah. So Warren called you about this?
So Warren called me, and he said, you think you can do for Dick Tracy? And I grew up with Dick Tracy. We would get the New York Daily News and the New York Daily Mirror. And in the Mirror, there was Joe Palooka, and there was Little Abner. In the News, Dick Tracy. Dick Tracy, oh my God. The Watch, I love Dick Tracy. So Warren said, you think you can do for Dick Tracy what Robert De Niro did for The Untouchables? And I should have said, of course. But I said, don't you think I ought to read what you have in mind? I didn't even know I knew the guy who wrote it, you know, and not Chester Gould, who made the comic strip, but a guy named Floyd Mutrix, who wrote the original script. And then he said, well, would you read around a table so I could hear it, because Warren was the director. I said, sure. And then he said, would Jenny read too? Jenny's my wife, the mother of my daughter and my son Sam, and the grandmother to my grandchildren. And I said, you have your own relationship with her. You talk with Jenny. She's not an actress. You know, talk with Jenny. And so I didn't hear any more about that. And what? Oh, my goodness. Have you been able to hear me? Oh, good. Okay, thanks. Thanks.
Resting on your shoulder there.
Okay. This is Siri, who puts everything together. I didn't miss it, but Pacino was just amazing in Dick Tracy. But I think Joe Pesci won the Academy Award that year. I voted for Al.
So tell us about A Glimpse of Tiger.
Ay, veyes mere. Well, that was to be the second picture I was producing, and I just finished working with Ingmar Bergman, came back to America, and I thought I was in charge, so I was producing, and of course I wasn't, and I didn't know that I had no perspective and no judgment. And when it came to having to deal and work with the business people, I really had to learn under fire, and as I said earlier, not to protect my success, but to get an education as to what's real and what this is all about. And that A Glimpse of Tiger then became What's Up Doc with Barbara and Ryan O'Neill.
This is such a fascinating bit of movie history, because you developed this project.
It was a project that was written by Herman Rauscher, who wrote The Summer of 42. And for me, my view of A Glimpse of Tiger was, it was The Little Prince. And The Little Prince was this girl in urban America. And I was the aviator. And you know, I had a lot to learn and had to give almost everything back, but I'm here.
So Warner Brothers closed the set, and there were some indications that you had been threatening the star of the film, Kim Darby, who incidentally was the little girl in the John Wayne True Grit. The story is that they collected an insurance policy by closing the set. Is that what happened? Or?
Well, not, you know, let's see, the picture. Kim was really frightened, and I said to Kim Darby, she was my choice for the picture. It actually should have been Jenny, my wife, who would have been amazing in the picture. The director was Tony Harvey, who had been Katharine Hepburn's favorite director.
Right.
He did Lion in Winter, and he also did They Might Be Giants with George C. Scott and Joanna Woodward. And I said to Kim, I'm playing this guy, I'm playing a character who is very frightening. He's so free, and he's very frightening, and you haven't seen this character yet. And I can't come back and forth so easily, but if you don't understand what I'm doing, just say, time, take me aside and talk with me. But I let me see, did I overact? As I said, I thought I was in charge, and I didn't understand why I would have to explain myself to my business partners. We had a script. I worked with the crew before. I had produced a picture called Little Murders, which was also very avant-garde and quite different. It just wasn't meant to be, which is something that Barbara had said to me when I couldn't do the part of Walker that was offered to me in Gandhi, the writer for life, because I had made A Bridge Too Far with and for Richard Attenborough. And then he had sent me a telegram to join the company of Gandhi to play Walker, but it didn't get to me in time because I wasn't with the same agency. And this is business, and I could teach a course in this now, but I promise you I'm not bitter, I'm not resentful, and I understand it now.
So Barbara said she was not meant to be.
What she said, it wasn't meant to
wasn't
be.
Wasn't meant to be.
Yeah, that was very good. Yeah.
Have you taken that to heart about when other things don't work out?
Oh, what's bashert is one of my favorite words. Whatever is meant to be is what's meant to be. Bashert is a great concept.
I want to talk a little bit about your life now. One thing that interests me, because you've mentioned it a few times this evening, how would you explain, how Jewish are you? I mean, does Judaism mean
more? Well, we'll put it this way. I'm going to see a urologist for the first time on the 7th. Is that Jewish enough? I said, no, my internist said, you'll go, we'll do a scan, and then if the scan says something, we'll do a bio. I said, wait a minute, I should see an expert. Let me see a specialist. So Bill Daniels, who's my friend, fabulous actor, created John Adams in 1776, was the president of my union, and he's gone through that. And, you know, and he gave me the name, and on the 7th, of this month, later in the week, I'm seeing a urologist who I haven't met yet, but I hope he gets a good look.
Gee, I think what I was meaning to ask was, do you feel more connected to the Jewish religion as you get older, or has it pretty much always been the same?
For me, personally, religion is discipline, and I believe in discipline. It's necessary, but I don't believe that any one can be better than any other one. And I am what I am. I understand more of what I am, which is one of us, which is a Jewish person. And I would think so. I work for almost all of us. I work for most, just about all of us. I probably couldn't work for all of us, and yet recently I did something called Listen to Grandpa Andy Ling for Eshat Torah. And Eshat Torah backed these three short little films, I'm Grandpa, and I could grow a beard, a white beard, it wasn't fake. And I have a 30-year-old grandson who's Chinese, being that his mother, who's my daughter in it, not my daughter in real life, married a Chinese engineer 30-some years ago, and now the only place for this 30-year-old Chinese-American to look for himself is his grandfather. It's pretty yeah. Good, you know. But you know, I'm sure I respect us all. And as far as the ethic and the culture, meaning is really important. I don't want to avoid confrontation, but most likely so. Most likely, yes, but I'm unorthodox, and yet the greater part of unorthodox is orthodox, and deep, 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 very much so.
Mm-hmm. Nice answer. And we want to take some questions, but I think a good way to end our part of the interview is I'd love for you to talk about Groucho Marx in the latter part of his life when you were an aide, or you helped him. Is that
no, he was my friend. We were friends. I was his friend, and he was my friend. And in his latter days, and Groucho, some of you, I have some friends in the audience. Groucho, I was going through my long hair overall. Mismatched. Well, this is a little provocative to wear a blue, my bar mitzvah suit with the striped gray.
I was going to say something about that.
I changed a light bulb, like one of these bulbs there, over his bed, and Groucho said to me, "That's the best acting I've ever seen you do." It's just the best review I've ever had. And Groucho did say that one place, and Ingmar Bergman said the same to me in his way. Neither of them had ever gotten to Israel, and they wanted to come to Israel. Mm-hmm. Now, I've been to Israel 2 times, and the first time I wore a Dolphins football team's stocking cap, the colors I like, it's blue and orange, and it says Dolphins, Dolphins, Dolphins. And I was taken to the wall twice in the same day, and we helped me do the tefillin. And I say, it's not that I like one team better than any other team, but that I consider myself to be a fellow mammal. And I point to one of the warm-blooded creatures, you know. And then recently I went back to Israel to serve as president of the jury at the 25th annual Haifa International Film Festival. And I had to address 1,400 people. And as I said, I don't really talk, although I guess you call this talking, but this isn't so linear, but I'm talking about my life. And so I said, this is what I said, and I can repeat it because I mean it. I mean it from my joints. I mean it from the deepest part of what I am. To thank Barbara Lane, to thank the staff, to thank the center, to thank all of you for your generosity in validating my work, although I know my work can't be validated by everyone here. And then I said, I believe that there's nothing of value other than what we have to share. And it's one thing to share goodness and accomplishment. It's another thing to share a problem. And once people are willing and capable of communicating directly like this, we could see that no one of us can have a problem that one of us didn't have before. Is there anybody that disagrees with that? It's possible. I mean, I would respect that. I don't think so. This is with me. It's about nature, and what we are. And then I said, I couldn't have imagined that one like this, like me, Elliott Goldstein, from 6801 Bay Parkway, Brooklyn 4, New York, P.S. 247. Seth Lowe Junior High and the Professional Children's School could get to the front and participate and contribute, and I'm there. And being at war with ignorance, desperation, and fear, if my body is blown away, but my heart is beating and my mind is working, I'm never going to call for help. It's taken me forever to get here, and I want to know that I'm giving everything. I also said prior to that, because that's so important to me in the news of the moment, whatever the moment is and wherever we are, with new buildings in Jerusalem and Israel and everything that's going on in the world, that I've made many pictures, more than 75, more than 75. I don't count. I mean, but here's the point, that some are better and some aren't, and the audience laughed, and Hi-Fi was pleased about that, but that I could look at anyone, if not everyone, and find a reason for participating, because I've lived through all of this, and I'm still working, and that's the key. So thank you, and thank everyone, and you tell me which direction to go into now.
So questions for Elliott Gould, just put up your hand and
now you're really
I've got the first one right over here.
Hi, Mr. Gould. I just wanted to say I read something that sounds like a lot of fun, and I wonder if it's true, that you regularly played cards with Phyllis Diller?
Oh, yes. Yeah, Phyllis, Barbara, I can be, Barbara was Phyllis's opening act before we met. And I believe that Phyllis had some influence on Barbara. And now with Barbara having her biography written, you'll probably see some of that. But I was at an event at the Philharmonic where they had known people. Now understand that my take on celebrity is simply that some of us have to make a bigger fool of ourselves than others. That's what celebrity is to me. And so Phil, they had guest conductors, and Phyllis conducted, I conducted. Frank Geary, I think, who built the place, he conducted. And so Phyllis and I became friends. And she likes guys, and she would cook for me. And she invented a card game called Diller Gin, which is a 7-card rummy game with deuces wild, and we used to play quite regularly.
Next question is over here, Elliott, to your right.
Well, getting to the lighter side of life, I remember one of your Ted and Carol, and it was a cutting edge because the hippie generation happened in San Francisco in 67. I think your picture came in 71, and takes Hollywood a little while to catch up what's happening. And I'd like to know what your experiences were with the stars and your perception of that.
Incidentally, he was nominated for an Oscar for that movie.
Yeah. thanks. I almost didn't do it because I thought it might have been exploitative, and I was extremely uptight and inhibited when it came to sexual stuff. And then when I met Paul Mazursky and Larry Tucker, who wrote it together, and Paul directed it, it was the first thing he directed, they played me the scene that Diane Cannon, who played Bob Carroll, Ted, and who played Alice, I was Ted, Bob Culp was Bob, and the great Natalie Wood was Carol. And it was very funny, and but in the scene where the four of us got into bed together, it wasn't in the script where I was brushing my teeth and gargling and putting deodorant on, and then when I took my jockey shorts off, I had a second pair on, so nothing really happened.
The next question's here in the front.
Ever since you were in MASH, and I remember being in, I think it was high school, and you dropped that olive in the martini glass and won over Donald Sutherland's heart, I kind of imagine you two sort of sitting at Musso's redoing that scene in one way or another, and I was curious to know if you two are still friends.
I recently called him. I wanted to hear his voice because we did two pictures after that. Donald plays a very wild priest in Little Murders. And then we did a picture called, that was titled Spies. And we haven't seen very much of one another, but we would have to be friends, you know. He once said that we were brothers. But I don't know that he ever came over for Pesach, but I never give up, you know.
The next question's up here to your left.
If I could only ever see one movie, it would be MASH. So I want to ask what your view is of the TV series. And also, do you think MASH could be done with the current wars in that context?
I must say that I was very gratified with the success of the television series. And I remember seeing Alan Alda at the Polo Lounge at the Beverly Hills Hotel, because he was more highbred, very highbred. And I remember when my mommy and my daddy took me to see his father do Guys and Dolls. It was Robert Alda was the original Sky Masterson. And I remember saying to Alan, you know, I mean, who is far more accomplished than I, I said, you know how good you are, and you know you're better than me. And if we could do what we did with MASH, you can do it too. Of course, he went on to make all that money. Altman could never deal with it. Altman would not ever have anything to do with it. I think the television series was good for the original film. Same music, same theme. And for years, I had thought about, no remake. But in the first Gulf War, I mean, I thought an international cast, and even now, you know, there has to be humor. There has to be humor, as difficult as it is. You know, maybe someone will do it. I don't know, but I can't wait around. But
next one is right here in front.
Who influenced you the most, your mother or father, and did they have your sense of humor?
Arthur Lawrence, who wrote The Home of the Brave and wrote the book to West Side Story and wrote the book to a Gypsy and wrote The Way We Were, the book. And I think he probably wrote the script too. Well, he directed me I Can Get a Few Wholesale with Barbara, of course. And as it went, we had to cast the character I played. And in it, there was never a mention of the father. Never a mention of the father. My father was, I love my father. He's probably the greatest guy I've ever known. And, but my mother was something more. And Arthur Lawrence said to me, how have you, shortly before he passed away, how have you stayed as good as you are, he said. And Arthur was mean. He was known to be mean, very smart and mean. And actually, in Barbara's book, she's asked me about talking with her biographer about how mean Lawrence was when she was rehearsing Miss Marmalstein and I Can Get a Few Wholesale. And I've recently thought, you haven't sung that. There's a new audience people don't know, and there's a song in it called What Are They Doing to Us Now? That's beyond belief, it's so great. I even had thought about Madonna doing it because we were friendly. But Arthur said, how could you have stayed as good as you are after everything you've been through? And I said, I don't think that way, but thank you. And my response would simply be that my mother never gave up. And I had no choice. You know, like I said, it's not about being someone. My mother and I, you know, the song in Wholesale is about the mother. What? Okay, what's the use of talking? It's as plain as plain. Just from where I got my good sense and my brain. All my better qualities, my looks and charm from a certain married lady that I love to pieces. My mom, mom. Why did you have to be made so perfectly, mom and new? Mama, who could I ever see half so good for me, mom and new? You'll have to come back for the second show to see the rest.
Why don't you write your memoir?
Last question.
Go ahead. Why don't you write your memoir? You've known everybody, and you remember everything about them.
I know. We'll see.
Okay, we'll take a question right here.
Hi.
The last one.
Can I have one more after the last one, please?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Whatever you want, Elliott.
Oh, great.
Hi. I was going to ask you a little bit. You touched upon your early childhood. Do you have brothers? Do you have sisters?
No brother, no sister. And then again, Molly, my daughter, Molly. And I have three grown sons. And now I've got these two amazing grandchildren. But Molly once said to me, in God's way, we're all brothers and sisters, which happens to be the Baptist approach. I'm not a Baptist, but I wouldn't mind.
Well, Elliott Gould, what a rare and delightful pleasure. Ruthe Stein, those red shoes are driving me crazy. Thanks to all of you in the audience, and thanks so much to you both for being here tonight. Good evening. The song, what a bonus.
I love the song. What's the name of the song?
The name of the song? Mama, Mama, Mama.
Mama, Mama, Mama. Is it something you can get at wholesale? Yeah.